The soul is the Father. The one who can say God gave his only begotten. The one who can say this is what? Forever everlasting? Amen.
Matthew was at work when Jesus came and called. When Jesus came and called, he was sitting at the seat of Pastor. He left his work, he left his job to say, let me follow Jesus. Welcome today to another good word. I've got a good word here once again. And I hope you enjoyed your New Year celebration, your Christmas and all that. You know, I was last year on Christmas time when we had a word on Christmas time. Hallelujah. So today I've got a good word which the Lord just said I should share. So I hope you got your Bible. I hope you got your notepad and you're just ready to receive. Hallelujah. Let me just start off with prayer. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for today. Thank you, Father, for everybody who's tuned in, who's listening to this live, or who will listen to this later. Father, I pray that their ears will be open to receive your word as it is on good ground, Lord. Let the word go in, my Father God. Let them receive it with joy and thanksgiving, and let them come back with a great harvest in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, so if you saw the banner, the poster, the banner which I put it there, welcome everybody. I can see you there if you're watching or if you comment. It's just I don't want to keep checking on my phone, but it's here on the side. So I just want to be flowing. So I acknowledge you and I thank you for your time, for connecting. Amen. Thank you so much. So like I'm saying, if you saw the banner, the revelation of the word is already given in what I put there in the banner. Amen. Praise God. But we're just going to get into it and I'm just going to explain it more. Okay, so this is what God explained to me. This is what the Father explained. And what I'm going to share with you is that joy equals victory. Hallelujah. Joy is actually victory. What do we mean when we say joy is actually victory? You know, most of the time, when do you see someone rejoicing? It's after they've won something, right? So after someone has, maybe they've won a prize. Oh, hallelujah. You know, they rejoice. Maybe after someone, we see it with football and stuff like that. You know, when the guys win the trophy, before the game, you know, before the match, everyone will be all serious and that, you know, the Rugby World Cup final, whatever. If it's the Champions League football final, everyone's so serious, they're just focused on the game. There's no rejoicing. The coach is telling them, hey, do this thing, do that thing. Everyone's just so serious. There's no rejoicing at that time. But when they win their trophy, man, something happens. When they win their trophy, something happens. You know, there's joy, there's rejoicing. There's so much joy that takes place, isn't it? So now, I want to show you in the kingdom of God how it works. It works a bit differently. It works in that your joy is actually the victory. Hallelujah. So you rejoice before the thing happens. So before you actually lift that trophy, before you actually get the victory, this is the time when you actually rejoice. You rejoice beforehand. And when you rejoice in advance, it's actually a sign that you are victorious. It's actually a sign that you've won. Hallelujah. I'm going to show you this from the Word of God. So let's just get into it. And then I'll just give some few examples and stuff like that. Let's go to Joshua. We all remember Joshua. Joshua was the one who took over from Moses, right? If you remember, you know, something amazing. Moses is the one who wrote the book of Exodus, right? And we find there, even in that book of Exodus, Moses is the author. And then Moses writes, there was none so meek as Moses. There was no man as humble as Moses. And he's talking about himself. Can you imagine, you write a book about yourself and you say, there was no one so humble as me. There was no one so good looking as me. There was no one so strong. Understand that. But he didn't say as me, he said as Moses. Okay, anyway, enough of that. Let's just go to, but you've got to have joy. Let's go to Joshua 5. So why I'm speaking about Moses? Moses didn't enter the promised land, right? It was Joshua who had to take over and enter the promised land. So you look at this. When we speak, like I'm saying, we speak and I'm saying like joy is victory, right? So why is it that those Israelites did not enter into the promised land? The reason they did not enter was because they kept on murmuring and they kept on complaining. They were like nonstop, bah, 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 Moses, you brought us here to kill us, you know. Moses like, hey guys, you guys were suffering there with the slave. It's like, you know, someone gets set free from something, they get to another level. Maybe you prayed, Lord, give me a business. He gives you a business. Then you're like, oh Lord, you gave me all these employees here just so they can come after me, you know, demanding salaries. No, you must thank the Lord to say you took me out of that thing, or you say, oh Lord, uplift me. Then he gives you responsibility. Maybe he puts you in charge of a church or a ministry. Then you're like, oh Lord, all these people here, they want to stone me. You know, they're not seeing the breakthrough. No, you don't look at that. Don't be like those Israelites. You continue rejoicing. You understand that? Just have joy. It's so great to have joy with the Lord. Hallelujah. Just have joy with the Father. You understand that? So this is why the Israelites, those guys didn't enter the promised land because of murmuring every time, bah, 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 complaining nonstop, complaining. Oh Lord, you said this, you know. Oh God, you said that. Where's that answered prayer? Where's that coming from? No, don't be like that, child of God, isn't it? Just be like Joshua. Hallelujah, Joshua the son of Nun. What a name! He was Joshua the son of Nun. Yeah, but that was his father's name, actually. Not to say he didn't have parents, but his father's name was Nun. Amen. Praise the Lord. So anyway, let's have a look at Joshua, what happened here. So there's a certain point when the Israelites were now moving forward, gaining ground, taking over the land. And then they got to Jericho. Now Jericho, I have a friend called Jericho, but anyway, he's in Dubai now. I don't know if he's watching, but bless you, Jericho, if you are. So anyway, what happened at Jericho is that Jericho was a well-fortified and protected city. You know, they had massive walls guarding it, surrounding it. And I believe even Rahab the prostitute, yeah, she lived in the wall. So that's how wide these walls were. And we understand they used to race horses on the walls of Jericho and all this kind of thing. So the Israelites had to break through these walls, isn't it? But they had the word of God that they're going to break. But they had to break through these walls. Now let's look at the strategy that they were given. Remember, Joshua was like the captain of the Lord, of the army. So let's go to Joshua 5. I take it from verse 13. Hallelujah. It says, and it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, are you for us or for our adversaries? And verse 14. And he said, nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord am I now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship and said unto him, what saith my Lord unto his servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, loose your shoe from your foot, for the place where you stand is holy ground. And Joshua did so. So look at this. This was an angel of the Lord, right? And Joshua came there, right? And he's like, are you for us or against us? And the angel was like, I'm not for you, I'm not against you, but I represent the Lord of hosts. So whoever, basically you're saying whoever God is for, that's who I'm for, isn't it? So look at this. Joshua had this encounter. So before that, look at this, verse chapter 6. Now Jericho was straightly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. Now look at this. I want to show you this, child of God. You may even have this happening in your life right now. When it says Jericho was straightly shut up, they were on lockdown. You understand that? The whole city was on lockdown. Not because of a government. Well, maybe it was a government forced lockdown. But this Jericho was on lockdown because they were afraid of the children of Israel. You understand that? Not because they wanted to, but they were scared. Isn't it? Verse 2, it says, and the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given into your hand Jericho and the king thereof and the mighty men of valor. Now look at this. I want to show you something. Can you see me here? I want to show you something. Look at this here. What happened here with Joshua? The Lord said unto him, see. So he said to Joshua, see, I have given you Jericho. So at times in your life, child of God, there's a word which you'll be given. Maybe God will speak to you and you'll say, see what I've given you. Remember, he said unto Abraham, see, look, if you can number the stars, so shall be your descendants. Look at the sands of the sea, so shall be your descendants. Isn't it? So that's what he said. So all I'm saying to you, child of God, is see what God has said to you. He said to Joshua here, see. See, I have given you Jericho. Understand that? Okay, let's continue. So, and this is when the father, well, that time it was God, said to him, okay, Joshua, go. You're going to walk around the city 7 times. This is from chapter 6 there. It says, you blow the trumpets, and when you blow the trumpets, let's go to Joshua 6 from verse 5. It says, and it shall come to pass that when you make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout. And the wall of the city shall fall down flat, and the people shall ascend up, every man straight before him. Now look at that, child of God. He's saying to him, you know what? This is what you're going to do. You're going to walk around the city. You're going to walk around the walls 6 times. On the 7th day, you're going to shout. So no one must shout up until then. And I believe when they were shouting with joy. You know, like, I'm a football fan, right? And my brother's a Liverpool fan. So now you know what happened with Liverpool during the lockdown. Those guys were losing at home, I tell you. Whatever was happening, you know, people could go to Anfield. If you don't understand football, just bear with me, you'll catch it. So anyway, these guys were, it was their home ground. But they were getting beaten because there were no fans in the stadium. But I tell you what now, child of God, you can check the record now. Ever since the fans have been allowed back into the stadium, there's nobody going to Anfield and having a good time. You understand that? Because of the shout. You understand that? Because of the cop. Isn't it? The crowd there, it strikes fear into the people. So look at this. The father knew something's going to take place. So not only does it happen in the natural, but even in the spiritual. So even at times when you have a problem, you just need to shout for victory. Hallelujah. You shout with joy. That's why when a football team or that rugby team, someone scores a try or something, the crowd goes crazy. You know, there's a shout. So I'm showing you in the kingdom of God, it works in reverse. You don't wait for the goal to be scored. You don't wait for the try to be touched down. You don't wait for the winning lottery ticket to come out to shout for joy. You shout for joy in advance. Because why? Because joy equals victory. So when you celebrate God in advance, that's when your victory is assured. That's why you got to praise him in the morning. David says, early in the morning will I praise you, Lord. So when you praise God early in the morning, that's when victory comes. I remember the one time I was in Cape Town and I was hosted by this one man of God. And I tell you, brother, it was blessed and everything. I slept there. But around 4 a.m., I started hearing singing, you know, and praising. And I was like, what's going on, man? Am I caught up here or something? You know, I was like, Lord, what's happening? Am I caught up here? Or what exactly is taking place? Then I realized, no, the woman of God is praying and praising God. Around 4, and I was hearing it, and I heard all her prayers and all that. I was like, wow, this is how we ought to actually start our day. You know, and I actually started also just praying in my spirit there during that time. But this is what happens. So anyway, let's fast forward and see what took place here. So these guys were only supposed to shout on the 7th day. So wake up in the morning, praise God. Your victory comes. You shout that your goal has been scored. You shout that the money has come through. You celebrate God before with joy. And when you do that, he's going to come up and say, oh, there's the thing you celebrated. It's the victory. Remember. So you prophesy your life. Hallelujah. You prophesy your life by celebrating in advance. So let's take a look. Let's go to verse 20, Joshua 6, verse 20. So the people shouted when the priest blew with the trumpets, and it came to pass when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, the people shouted with a great shout that the wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. Look at that. So you see what happened with these walls. It was like, if you allow me, you see, this is the Bible, right? So these were the walls, and I believe the city was behind. So when these cities fell down, what happened is they fell like this. They fell flat, but it became like a ramp. You understand that? So that the children of Israel could just walk in. Get that? They could just walk into the city. So look at that. Everyone had to shout with a shout. Can you imagine? It sounds foolish, huh? Can you imagine if someone, let's say someone comes to me and says, hey, I'm facing this sickness. Then I say, all right, shout, I'm healed 5 times or something like that. I'm like, this guy is crazy. can you just lay hands on me or something? Can you just come and pray here, powerful prayer? Don't play games with me. But if the Lord says, shout for joy, shout, I'm healed, I'm healed, I'm healed, I'm healed, I'm healed, isn't it? And you see the healing manifest. It seems foolish, but that's the victory, isn't it? I remember the one time I was in one service, and then the man of God said to this, called the one guy out. He was a business guy. And he said to him, jump three times and shout Jesus. You know, it seemed foolish. A grown guy, you know, he's a wealthy guy. He's got money and all that for him to jump. But I tell you, he jumped and he jumped high. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He jumped like that, you know. And people were like, what's going on? This is the prophet is just playing around with guys. But what happened is, I think it was within 2 weeks, he came and he testified. And he said, I received 3 investors into my business. Hallelujah. So it was the shouting and the jumping 3 times, which was a shout of joy and a shout in advance, which brought him the victory. So understand that, child God. Rejoice in God. You get me? Rejoice in God. Always just rejoice in Him. Praise Him in advance. That's why you find someone who testifies will always get more testimonies. So I'll encourage you. Keep on testifying. Keep on enjoying God. You know, Psalm 37, it says, delight yourself in the Lord and He will give you what? The desires of your heart. Amen. Praise God. So just delight Him. So I want us to go. Let's go to 2 Chronicles. Another one is a common scripture. Well, we can't call the word of God common. But anyway, what I'm saying here is that it's one which most people should know. 2 Chronicles, take it from chapter 20. Let me read from verse 2. Now, this was after the children of Israel had taken the promised land. They were now enjoying life. It's many generations after. But anyway, let's see what happened. There was a king at that time, King Jehoshaphat. Okay, so chapter 20 from verse 2 says, then they came that told Jehoshaphat, saying, there cometh a great multitude against thee from beyond the sea on this side of Syria. And behold, there be in Hezron, Tamar, which is in Gedi. And Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. Look at that. So he proclaimed the fast now. Not to say you should fast every time, but if you're led by the Lord, yes, you can fast, isn't it? Don't go on hunger strikes, try and get God to do something. If the Holy Spirit directs you to fast, fast, isn't it? So anyway, but now this king, the messengers came and said, look, my friend, you are in trouble. You are surrounded left, right, and center. You are in trouble. There's many guys coming there to... Remember those days, they had scouts would go up and check. So maybe in your life, you can be like, someone can come and say, the doctor can come and say, I'm sorry, but you are in trouble. You've got this, 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 and this. And then the bank or whatever, maybe your landlord comes and says, you are in trouble. Can you get out of my house? You lose your job. You know, all those kind of things. So this king decided to proclaim a fast. And then, you know, he prayed a powerful prayer. You can read it there. And he said, are you not God alone? You know, you are the one who has power to lift up, to put down, all that. But I want you to check. Let's go on to chapter 20, verse number 12. Look at what he said here. This was the king, Jehoshaphat. He said, oh, our God, will you not judge them? For we have no might against this great company that comes against us. Neither know we what we should do. But our eyes are upon you. Our eyes are upon you. Our eyes are on you. Hallelujah. So you put your eyes on Jesus. You understand that? It's like a child. I always use this example. A child, if at school they tell him about school fees, he doesn't go and try and make a plan to get school fees. Or if they tell him you need these books or something at school, what do they do to the children at school? They tell them, go and tell your parents that you need to pay this money. This money needs to be paid. Go tell your parents you need to bring lunch. Go tell your parents... you know, this and that and the other. They don't tell the children, or try and get it out of the kid there to say, hey, where's the money? You understand that? They don't do that. So this is what King Jehoshaphat knew. And he said, Lord, we have no strength in ourselves. Our eyes are on you. So even you, child of God, as you're there, you are a child of God. Your eyes are on the Father. If there's pressure coming to you, it's not, you're not going to get it out of yourself, isn't it? Your eyes have got to be on Jesus. And this is where it comes from. Let's see what happened. Verse 13. So that's what the king said. Then all Judah stood before the Lord with the little ones. See, the kids were there, the wives and the children. Then upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaniah, the son of Jeliel, the son of Matan, all these, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation. So now the anointing came upon him. Verse 15. And he said, hearken you, all Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem, and you, King Jehoshaphat, thus says the Lord unto you, be not afraid nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. It's like, as I explained to you, it's not for the kids to pay the school fees. It's not for the kids to provide for themselves. So even here, the Spirit of God came on this this prophet here, this priest, and he said, listen, battle's not yours, it's God's. Understand that. So even in everything that you do, even if we go on there, verse 7, he said, when you come up, you will not find, isn't verse 17, he said, you shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourself, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you, the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow, go out against them, the Lord will be with you. So this is the prophetic word which they had to say that the battle is not yours, it's the Lord's. You don't need to fight in this battle. You remember even Moses, when he was at the Red Sea, and the children of Israel were there, and they were murmuring, complaining to him. And the armies of Egypt came behind them, chasing after them. And now, he cried to God, said, oh Lord, what am I going to do? And the Lord said, don't cry to me, stretch forth your hand, isn't it? So after, if you cry to God, God will tell you what to do. So he said, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. This is exactly the same word. After they're now in the promised land. So you see what happens, child of God, is maybe you can come through a situation. You see, maybe you're in the world, you're delivered from the world, you come out. Now you're in the kingdom. You're like, Lord, you set me free from that thing. But now there's another thing. It's like the testimony. Let's have a look at, who can we say? If we see like Jesus, for example, okay. These disciples are moving with Jesus. They're seeing miracles. They're seeing signs. They're seeing wonders. They're delivered from the world. They're walking with him. Then next thing, gotcha. Jesus is crucified. And we understand all of them ran away, isn't it? It was only the women who like came close and stood close. And I think it was John the Beloved. So anyway, it was like over for them. Can you imagine? Peter and all of them were like, oh, it's over, guys. Let's go back to fishing, isn't it? But even in the midst of that, you know, it's like where God has taken you out of something. Then you think, oh, well, it's over. That breakthrough was for that time. The money was for that time, or the healing was for that time. Now I'm stuck, I've got another problem, it's over, I guess the joy is gone. No! You're going to do it again, isn't it? Just like with the children of Israel, he took them out of Egypt, brought them into the promised land. Now in the promised land, the enemy is coming again. But look, they get delivered. Let's check what happens here. Verse 19. So the king just had this word that they don't need to fight. But look what the king did, verse 19. And the Levites... Okay, let's take it from verse 18. And Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshipping the Lord. Look at that. They were worshipping him after the word came. So even as now I'm giving you the word to say, hey, look, God has given you the victory. Rejoice. Rejoice. Now when you rejoice, you will see the victory happen. Verse 19 says, and the Levites of the children of who and who stood up to praise the Lord, O God of Israel, with a loud voice on high. Right. So they were manifesting, they were praising God, like declaring the victory before it happened. So that's what you got to do. Right, verse 20. Says, and they rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness, or wah, 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 wah. And Jehoshaphat stood there and said, hear me, O Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you shall be established. Believe in his prophets, so shall you prosper. Look at what the king said. 21. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord that should praise the beauty of holiness as they went out before the army to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever. And when they began to sing and praise the Lord, and praise the Lord sent ambushments. Look at this. So this king wasn't told, the Lord didn't say, listen, Jehoshaphat, tomorrow send the worship team in advance, go and praise me. No, he only had a word, right? He only had a word which said what? The word said, you don't need to fight in the battle, I've given you the victory. And now he says, okay, since God has given us the victory, let's celebrate. So even that's what I'm saying to you. Celebrate in the midst of where your bank account is on zero. You don't have a rental or that big project you have. Listen, when you have such a big vision and such a big project, that's when you know it's from God. And the battle is his. It's not for you to try and look how you're going to fulfill that project, is it? He gave you the word. Now you stand on his word and say, rejoice. Thank you, Jesus. You said this is going to be so. You said I'll travel nations. You said my business will be international. You said my family, kids will be blessed and everything. That's what you stand on. So this is what the king did. He decided just to praise God. Now, I want you to take a note of something. Verse 22. First, Second Chronicles 20, verse 22. It says, when they began to sing and to praise the Lord and praise Then the Lord sent ambushments against the children of Ammon, Moab, Mount Seir, which were come against Judah. And they were smitten. For all the children of Ammon and Moab stood up against the inhabitants of Mount Seir, utterly to slay and destroy them. And when they had made an end of the inhabitants of Seir, everyone helped to destroy another. Look at that. Verse 23. So there was confusion in the enemy's camp. Everyone began, the enemy began to fight each other. They were all coming to say they're going to fight Israel, but they ended up fighting each other. Look at that. And then when Judah came down, they looked on the multitude, and behold, there were dead bodies fallen to the earth, and none escaped. Look at that. It says, and when Jehoshaphat and his people came to take away the spoil of them, they found among them in abundance both riches with the dead bodies, precious jewels stripped off them, more than they could carry away, and they were 3 days in gathering of the spoil. 3 days. 3 days gathering the wealth. Okay. So, you know, I remember this one time, not so long back, they tried to rob one of my brothers. You understand that? They came, they snatched his bag out of the car, something like that. And he saw all this happening and his courage, boldness, went after those guys there, you know. And he actually jumped on the bonnet of the vehicle. And these guys were like, I think they were doing rounds robbing people because they were all in the car. But the fellow with his backpack, and that backpack, I tell you, it was often in church carrying Bible, so it's anointed. So as he's on the vehicle, he's just watching as he's seeing, okay, I can see the driver's face. Next thing, he's checking at the back. The friends of this thief put their friend out of the back of the vehicle, put him. Then he fell hard. He was just watching, say, what's going on here? And the chap falls hard, face first. His bag drops and his hat dropped. And then next thing, my brother was like, oh, well, I just wanted my bag. He jumps off the bonnet of the car. The car drives away, picks up his bag and goes. So that's confusion in the enemy's camp. You understand that? It's where like people try to come against you. That's why the Lord says they can surely gather against you, but they'll come together. They'll come against you one way, but flee several different ways. Understand that? So everything, whatever comes against you, maybe it can seem like everybody's talking against you, your family members, or there's so many problems coming against you. I tell you, they'll flee. They can come one way, they'll flee seven ways. Understand that? This is the victory which God gives you. So look at this child of God. These guys, the king said, listen, we're going to rejoice. Understand that? We're going to have joy. We're going to give joy to the Lord in advance. And they went singing, imagine, into the midst of battle. Now, there's something I want you to understand. In the time of Jericho, what happened when they were by the walls of Jericho? The soldiers went first, and then the priests came, and then the Ark of the Covenant. So the soldiers went armed in front, and then the priests came, isn't it? And then when the command to shout joy, the soldiers were in front. But in this point, look at it, the praises were in front, the worship team were in front. You understand that? So that's where the joy cometh from. Hallelujah. And you know, there's something about when you let out of, when you come out of a situation, the joy which comes. But like I'm saying to you, no matter what situation you're facing, I'll encourage you, rejoice in God now. Delight yourself in Him now before it happens. You know, even throughout the Psalms, you know, we read and we see of all the great things, you know, you can read throughout all the Psalms. Even Nehemiah 8:10 says, you know, don't be sorry for what? For the joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy of the Lord is your strength. I'll just take one or two Psalms. I'm sure you know many. But there's joy when you rejoice in God. So like I'm saying to you, just rejoice in Him. And as you just have joy with God, you are actually declaring a victory in advance, isn't it? So let's just have a look here at Psalms 5, verse 9-11. That's a nice one, I know. Speaking of shouting for joy. So I believe when the children of Israel shouted, it was a shout of joy. Let's go there. Psalms 5 verse 11. Look, it says, but let all those that put their trust in thee rejoice. Let them ever shout for joy because you defend them. Let them also that love your name be joyful in you. So you shout for joy and you know that you are what? You are just joyful in God. Hallelujah. You rejoice in Him. You're joyful in Him. He's always giving you victory. And God delights in your prosperity. That's like, I think it's Psalms 35. He delights in your prosperity. Let's go Psalms 35 verse 27. It says, let them shout for joy and be glad. You understand that? Saying, let them shout. So you got to shout, child of God. It says, let them shout for joy that favor my righteous cause. Yea, let them say continually, the Lord be magnified, which has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So you just got to shout for joy. Delight yourself in the Lord. Yeah, Psalms 37 verse 4, there it is right there. Delight yourself in the Lord and He shall give you the desires of your heart. Amen. Praise the Lord, child of God. So I just want to encourage you, you know, just know that you have joy, child of God. You understand that? Just know that when you have joy, you have victory. You know, like I explained the last time. Often when I pray, like if I'm praying over a prayer point, like, okay, I give you an example. Yesterday, my little doggy went missing, Lucy. At times, maybe you hear a dog barking in the background when I do these lives. That'll be Lucy, you know. She's always barking. But thank God today she's quiet. So anyway, what happened with Lucy? There were some fireworks going off and all that. And then Lucy went missing, you know. In the morning, we couldn't find her. And Lucy is a female, and she won't go like our male will go for a dog on heat or that. So anyway, she disappeared. And we're wondering, where is Lucy? Lucy doesn't go and not come back. If she comes out of the gate somehow, she'll always be back soon. She doesn't go far. So next thing, we couldn't find her. So my mom was like, no, we got to check for your dog and all that kind of thing. So anyway, what happened is I prayed, you know. And like I'm saying to you, when you pray, at times you get a victory note of like joy. Like maybe at times you've been in a church service, you just find someone laughing with joy. Ah, quack, 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 nonstop. At times the person doesn't even know why they're laughing. Why are they laughing? It's because the spirit man. The spirit man is connecting to say, hey, I've got the victory. Saying tintiness, I've tinted something, you know, I've touched something. I've touched something in the spirit. So that's why, like, even the children of Israel, you know, when they were going out singing, it takes some guts to go against an army with which is armed, going and singing, praise the Lord, say, praise the Lord, we'll shoot your head off. You know what I mean? So you got to have something in you which is confirming that you got the victory. So this is what happened here. Like I'm saying to you, okay, I was praying and I was like, Lord, my dog, please return my dog, you know, return Lucy, let her come back home. And then I just felt joy bubbling up inside of me. I was like, ah. And you know, I didn't even bother to go looking for her or anything. I was thinking, but then my mom was like, hey, we got to look for the dog. But you know, I had this joy inside of me, which was the confirmation of victory. And then just as soon as we said, okay, let's put a poster to say the dog is missing, immediately someone said, hey, this dog, we saw it today. We just took it to SBC, isn't it? And she was back, you know, and she was so joyful. If I have to show you how when we came there, you know, it's like, you basically, it's like bailing out someone. So we bailed it out, you know. We bail the dog out of the SPCA. It was in a holding cell. So it's just like, you know, this is what the Lord does. You understand? So you don't have to wait for someone to come and bail you out. I don't know if you've ever been arrested. If you have, or if you haven't, it doesn't matter. But at times life can maybe like seem to have you in a prison. And then, you know, God sets you free through Christ. He bails you out of that situation, isn't it? There's joy and victory which comes. You run free. You're happy. You understand it? So I'm saying to you, rejoice and be happy with the Lord. Before anything manifests, because this is how it happens in the kingdom of God. It seems foolish, but joy equals victory. So know that when you're praying or, you know, in anything in life, and how you can say, hey, I got so many problems, how can I rejoice? No, I'm telling you, rejoice. When you rejoice, victory will have to happen. You know, like I remember Kenneth Hagin, when they said to him, what do you do when you know you need finances and you don't have finances? He said, you know what I do? He says, I laugh at the devil. Says, I take my checkbook out and I put it there. I put my wallet there and I start laughing at it. He says, I laugh to say this thing is telling lies. It's telling me I can't afford this thing. It's telling me I can't pay for this thing. So he says, I just sit and I laugh at it. And then the money comes. He says, that's how I do it. Say, don't you pray fast or declare things? He says, no, I'm telling you what I do. I just laugh at it. I just laugh at the lie of the enemy. I laugh at it. Praise God. So all you got to do, child of God, is rejoice in God. That's where your victory comes from. Just be happy, you know. 1 Thessalonians says, rejoice in the Lord. And again, I say rejoice. Hallelujah. So in closing, I just say to you, thank you for watching. And it's been a year ago. I'm just rejoicing in God. I'm feeling a bit like drunken in the Holy Spirit, which is joy, which is fine, which is good. I hope you also get a shakadungi. May you be zapped by the power of God. May you rejoice in God. May you know your Father, that He's a loving Father. He's a joyful Father. And He wants you to enjoy life. So rejoice in Him. Don't struggle. Listen, don't be like the children of Israel, right? Those guys missed it because they kept on complaining. Oh, you took us out of Egypt to kill us. Oh, we had this and that. And oh, you understand that. Don't be like them. Be like Joshua. Joshua said, look, the Lord has... Some people saw giants. At times you can be facing a problem. You can be looking at the problem. Don't look at the problem. Joshua and Caleb didn't see giants. They said, they're bread for us. We're going to eat these guys up. The other 10 spies said, we're going to die, guys. But the two, they said, this is ours. So when God gives you the word, like King Jehoshaphat had the word, listen, You don't need to fight. The battle is not yours. It belongs to the Lord. So you're just watching. It's like wrestling, you know. You're watching the, you on the outside, and you already know, you know, some wrestling, they kind of like know who the winner is before the match. So if that's how you are, and you're on the winning side. So just rejoice in God, and I bless you, and I say 2022 is yours. Be blessed. This is the Wednesday, what is it? Weekly Wednesday word. Yeah, you're right. Every Wednesday, 8 p.m., by the grace of God, I'll be coming, giving you a word, whatever the Father says to me to share. God loves you. I love you. Just like, share, follow, subscribe. If you haven't received Christ, there's a prayer coming up in the closing video. Pray that prayer and you will experience what we're talking about. God bless you. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you for listening. Thank you for watching. Remember to like, follow, subscribe, and share this word and share this message. If you're not sure about your salvation, you're not sure if you're saved, say the prayer to follow. The greatest miracle is salvation.
Lift up your hands to heaven. Everyone, just lift up your hands to heaven. Hallelujah. And just say this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, today,
today
I've heard your word.
I've heard your word.
And I believe,
and I believe
that you are the Son of God.
That you are the Son of God.
I believe that you love me.
That you love.
That you died for me.
That you died for me.
That you rose from the dead for me.
That you rose from the dead for
me. And I take you, Jesus.
I take you, Jesus.
As my Lord.
As my Lord.
As my God.
As my God.
As my King.
As my
Savior,
my life.
In Jesus' name,
in Jesus' name,
amen,
amen,
hallelujah.